You have a bunch of plastics with you and you don't know what these are? Then this video is for you. Here, we will demonstrate a straightforward way for you to identify the plastics. No more burning plastics or suffering from unpleasant odors. This is a quick and easy way for you to find out your type of plastic. And best of all, you don't have to be a plastic expert. You can let technology do everything for you. Sit back, relax while the instrument gives you the type of plastic, without sacrificing your sense of smell. Join me as I show you how to distinguish one type of plastic from another. And by the end of the video, you'll be able to identify the type of plastic like a seasoned pro. We're going to be looking at a technique called the Fourier transform infrared spectroscopy, also called FTIR in short. Let the name not intimidate you, because I'm going to break it up so that you can understand what this technique is all about. This method uses IR rays which are exposed onto the plastic. The IR rays are characterized by what is called wave number, which is nothing but the spatial frequency of the rays. The wave number range for this method is between 4000 per centimeter to 400 per centimeter. As the IR rays are directed towards the plastic sample, they interact with the molecular bonds that make up the plastic. For instance, polyethylene is made up of carbon-carbon and carbon-hydrogen bonds, while PVC is comprised of carbon-chloride bonds, among others. These bonds respond differently to the IR rays by absorbing specific wave numbers of the rays. This absorption occurs as a result of the bonds stretching, bending, or twisting, causing a unique pattern of absorption at different wave numbers. The IR rays of the other wave numbers pass on through to the detector. The interesting part is that each plastic has a fingerprint of the IR spectrum from which we can find out the family of the plastics. Thus, by analyzing the IR absorption spectrum, we can gain valuable information about the type of plastic, the exposure conditions, or any contaminants. So the fingerprint IR pattern that we get from the sample is matched against a pre-existing library of plastics that are already inbuilt into the machine. So the final output that you get from the IR test is nothing but the percentage absorption in the y-axis against the wave number in the x-axis. Some models also give you the percentage of transmittance against the wave number. The transmittance is nothing but 100 minus the percentage of the absorbance. I have four plastic samples that I pulled out from different applications. Now let's have a look at what these are made of. The first sample is this white bar that is used as part of a board. We are going to cut a thin slice from this material and place it on the instrument opening. After a minute, the final graph is displayed. We have an option to automatically match the polymer fingerprint with the list of polymers existing in the database to get the closest equivalent. Here, our sample is an 86.89% match with the polyethylene sample found in our database. The software can also provide the type of functional groups which are present in the sample. For a polymer chemist enthusiast, this would be useful. Here, we see that the sample is primarily made of aliphatic hydrocarbons, which are nothing but open-chained carbon-hydrogen bonds. The characteristic peaks for polyethylene are broadly in the range between 2800 to 2950 per centimeter. And more specifically, in this spectrum, we see the peaks are at 2915 per centimeter and 2847 per centimeter. Strong absorption is also seen near 1470 per centimeter. So, polyethylene is usually classified as LDPE, LLDPE, UH, MWPE, HDPE. There is a characteristic peak of HDPE where it shows a split peak near 715 to 730 per centimeter. However, it is wise to always cross-check that it is indeed HDPE using another thermal analysis technique called the differential scanning colorimetry. This helps you identify the melting point of the polymer. The link to this video is found in the description below. All right, next, we're going to be looking at this car dashboard material. Just like in the earlier case, we're going to cut a portion of the sample and place it under the instrument. Let's see what this is made of. The spectrum shows the sample is made up of polypropylene combined with polyethylene. The downside is that we cannot find the exact composition of polypropylene that is mixed with polyethylene unless that combination is already present in our library. The differential scanning colorimetry, which I mentioned earlier, can also be used to find out the percentage composition of the polypropylene and polyethylene. Pause right here if you wish, check out that thermal analysis technique, and jump right back in. The next sample was taken from the body of a printer. The FTIR spectrum shows a major peak at 1771 per centimeter, which is characteristic of polycarbonate. The major peak at 1450 per centimeter is characteristic of butadiene. Pairing this with the library, we get an 80% match with PCABS. The final sample that we're going to be looking at is nylon 4,6, which is a straight-chained polyamide. On closer analysis, we see the main presence of aliphatic hydrocarbons due to the presence of peaks near 2800 to 3000 per centimeter. Also, a C double bond O stretch is usually observed at wave numbers between 1690 to 1630 per centimeter for amides. Well, of course, you don't need to know about all these wave numbers or what aliphatic hydrocarbons are, because the instrument is going to give you the final result anyway. However, if you want to go deeper into the subject and find out the nuances of different kinds of polymers, this would be useful. While matching with the library, it only shows a 71% match with nylon 6,6. And this is because we do not have nylon 4,6 in our library. And that is why you always need to understand a little bit about the wave numbers and where you find the peaks. And surprise, surprise, you can always double check the precise type of nylon using the DSC technique through the melting point. This brings us on to the advantages and disadvantages of the FTIR method. The first advantage is that it is quick. Testing should not take more than a few minutes. Secondly, no in-depth preparation is necessary and you only need a small amount of sample. This technique can also help you understand the type of contaminants that are present in the sample, provided they are already configured in your library. And coming to the disadvantages, you will need an extensive list of library to cover a wide range of applications. Quantification of the percentage of polymers present in a copolymer can be done if the library is present. And finally, maintenance is crucial. FTIR cannot be switched off due to the presence of critical electronics present inside. I hope you enjoyed this video and learned about this quick and easy way to identify a plastic. If you have a challenging plastic in hand, feel free to reach out and I'll be able to assist you in trying to identify the plastic. And as always, if you got any value out of this video, do like and subscribe to this channel so that you'll be updated on any material testing videos coming up in future.